Hello. Welcome. Welcome to the People's Town Hall meeting. A couple of things before we start. If you can move forward and squish together a bit, there's quite a few people here, as you may have noticed. We want to make sure that as many people as possible have a chance to get in. My name is Patrick. I'm a member of the steering committee of Indivisible Charlottesville. Thank you. So, as you may know, this is the last day of a week-long congressional recess. Traditionally, our members of Congress use these breaks to meet with their constituents, and this meeting was arranged because our representative, Tom Garrett, chose not to schedule a town hall during this week. In association with Crozet Act, Indivisible, Fluvanna, Progressive Democrats of America, Central Virginia, the Madison Huddle, Indivisible Nelson, All In for All, Charlottesville Now, SURJ, thank you, SURJ, Charlottesville, Charlottesville DSA, and Together Cville, we've convened the People's Town Hall and invited our congressman to attend. We're very disappointed that he has declined our invitations. Nevertheless, we persist. We're here to ask questions that deserve answers and tell stories that need to be shared. We will make sure that Congressman Garrett hears what you say today. Just by holding this event, you've already pressured Garrett to schedule at least two future town hall events. The next will be held in Charlottesville on March 13th, and we will all definitely be there. We don't know what the schedule of that event is going to be like or if Congressman Garrett will be taking questions from the audience, so it's very important that we get ourselves on record today. Let's check in really quick. If you are a voter in the 5th District and one of Congressman Garrett's constituents, please raise your hand. It looks like all of us. I mean all of us in the 5th District. All right. Before we begin, just a couple of quick announcements. First, you may have been approached by representatives of several local and state campaigns today. Democracy is a beautiful thing. The presence of those campaigns here should not be necessarily construed as endorsement by any of the convening organizations. Two, Charlottesville High School wants me to be very clear with you that this is not a school-sanctioned event. We're not affiliated with Charlottesville Public Schools. And speaking of this event not being school-sanctioned, members of the Indivisible Charlottesville Steering Committee have actually paid quite a bit of money for us to be able to use this space. If you find yourself feeling generous, thank you. Not me. If you find yourself in a position to be generous and feel so moved, there'll be folks at the exits with some buckets to accept any donations that you might wish to give. Our checks from George Soros and the Koch brothers have not yet come in. When yours does, you can like cut us a percentage. Any excess proceeds that we don't need to defray the cost of this event will be donated at the request of our moderators to Amnesty International. And if you haven't already, turn off your cell phones. So that's enough from me. So I'd like to move into our program by introducing our two moderators. Saad, Khaleefa, and Kibiriti, Majuto, are both students at Charlottesville High School. Both are leaders and activists and have lobbied Washington on behalf of refugees. Please welcome Saad and Kibiriti.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. How are you doing today? Everyone do this with me. When I say, show me what democracy looks like, you say, this is what democracy looks like. Show me what democracy looks like.
This is what democracy looks like.
Show me what democracy looks like. My name is Kibiriti Majuto.
And my name is Saad Khaleefa.
And we would like to welcome you to our community's first town hall meeting for Representative Tom Garrett.
And fortunately, Congressman Garrett declined our invitation, but we want to celebrate the fact that because of you and your determination, he has announced a series of town halls starting in March.
Today, we want to give you voice to speak up about a number of important topics, including healthcare, immigration, education. We want you heard. These issues affect you.
We know many of you are very eager to voice your opinion and ask questions, and this is how today's town hall will work. Here are the rules.
We expect this to remain organized and civil discussion.
Everyone is welcomed here.
Be courteous to all.
Make room for others.
Sorry, boss.
Where you at? Be courteous to all. No personal insult or abusive language.
Make rooms for others.
Respect us as your moderators.
Wait for us to acknowledge you before you speak, please.
Questions will be addressed to us or Representative Garrett. No other audience.
Today's town hall will be recorded. We will collect your questions and concerns and communicate them to Garrett.
Here's how voicing your questions will work. If you have a question, please raise your hands. When a volunteer with a mic,
there you go.
When a volunteer with a mic has come to your aisle, please step into the aisle.
In order to address the concerns of as many constituents as possible, we will have our two volunteer timekeepers. Please meet Sarah, and Elizabeth. Who will give each person 2 minutes to ask their question. If anyone goes over time limit, Sarah and Elizabeth will hold up a sign like so. And we will ask for you to hand the mic back.
We would love to see from you when you strongly agree or disagree. Let's practice with your signs. Who agree this is what democracy looks like?
I would like to remind you all of our purpose here today, which is civil discourse. We must address only the issues. If a person is being disruptive, they will be asked to leave. Let's keep this respectful. This is what democracy looks like.
I will start off by introducing our first topic, healthcare. Let's first hear from Representative Garrett's own words.
Here's what Tom Garrett has said about the ACA. One cannot reasonably debate the effectiveness of Obamacare. To date, it is a disaster. Obamacare is worse than the problem it was meant to solve.
This is nice. I like the signs.
He wrote that he is proud to undo Obamacare while also promising to ensure that we will have coverage for folks with pre-existing conditions. At the same time, Gary admit that he's skeptical about the possibilities of a repeal and replace plan. I'm somewhat doubtful how we can get this done, but it is something we should be doing, he said in his Facebook town hall.
Next, we'll hear a constituent testimonial about healthcare.
Hey, everyone. I guess normally in town halls you would face the stage, but I guess it makes more sense to face the people that actually bothered to show up. So my name is Waleed, and I have a testimonial that relates to healthcare. I can hold it a little bit closer. Is that better? Okay. So my name is Waleed, and I'm here to talk about healthcare. I am a recently graduated physician who really cares a lot about the Affordable Care Act. This may not be a personal issue for me, but it's very, very personal for the patients that I take care of, certainly. I've taken care of people with great insurance, and I've taken care of people with no insurance at all. And there's really no easy way for me to convey what a challenge it can be getting a patient the care that they need if they don't have the coverage that they need. Coverage dictates pretty much everything that we do. When you're working with a population where coverage isn't necessarily a guarantee, not an hour goes by where we're not talking about patients' coverage. Before I order an expensive medication, I have to think about what insurance they have. Before I order an expensive imaging study, I have to think about what coverage they have. Before I make a referral for something as simple as mental health, I have to think about what insurance coverage they have. I can prescribe every medication in the world to treat a patient that I think needs it, but if they walk up to the pharmacist counter and are told that it's going to cost $100 out of pocket, they're not going to pick it up, so I can't even think about it. And honestly, I can't blame someone that doesn't pick it up in that situation. And that's really to say nothing of the people that I don't even see in clinic because they don't have the coverage to come in. I see those people in a completely different setting, in the hospital, when they come in with something catastrophic that could have been prevented years later had they come into clinic with coverage that they would have had when it really mattered. So with that in mind, for Congressman Garrett, who voted in favor of the budget resolution to repeal the Affordable Care Act, I have three questions to ask. The Congressional Budget Office estimated that in the first year of a repeal, 18 million people would lose coverage. So I have to ask, does he think that that's responsible to voters to go forward with a repeal? And the Committee for Federal Responsibility for a Federal Responsible Budget estimated that it's going to cost $350 billion over the next 10 years to repeal the Affordable Care Act. With that in mind, does he think it's responsible to the taxpayers to move forward with a repeal? And lastly, for the people that have pre-existing conditions who can finally, under the ACA, get coverage no questions asked, a lot of these alternative plans have suggested maybe switching to high-risk pools, which we've had in the past. And history has showed us that they're ineffective, they're costly, and they don't even cover the conditions that you need them to cover. So I have to ask him, is it responsible to people that have real disease to move forward with a repeal? Those are my three questions. Thank you.
Now we have time for your questions and concerns about healthcare. Please raise your hand if you would like to share. Wait for a volunteer with a mic to come to your row and then walk in the row.
The woman with that.
Well, I'm a physician also. I work at the cancer set. I'm a physician also. My name is Leslie Blackhall. I work in palliative care at University of Virginia. And I can tell you, every one of my patients has a pre-existing condition from hell, really. And I'm old enough that I remember the days when they would be working at Walmart full-time, get their cancer, and have to get treated and get fired because they couldn't make it to their job, and then be unable to get their cancer care. Not only that, but it's one thing to cover pre-existing conditions, but I'm old enough to remember the days when many insurances had a cap, which you had no idea of, and it doesn't take long if you have cancer, if you have ALS, if you have heart disease, if you have HIV, before you reach the cap and your insurance tells you, No more money will we spend on your care. And so I actually called Representative Garrett 5 times, and also I called every Republican representative in the state of Virginia to ask them a question. And the question was, what are you going to do for my patients? How are you going to keep them from dying painful deaths and from not getting the care they need? And here's the thing that nobody mentions about healthcare also, is that the Speaker of the House, Representative Ryan, and Tom Price, the new head of the HHS, what they want to do is make Medicare into a voucher system. I don't think really anybody wants that. And so that's my question. They've been saying for the past 8 years that they have a really great plan. Where is it?
Thank you. Any other questions or concerns?
There. I know.
Hi. Sorry, I'm a little nervous. Sorry, a little nervous. Missy Wernstrom, live in Charlottesville, work at UVA. I'm not actually in the medical, thank you. I'm not actually in the medical field. I am in fact a patient. I have a chronic disease that is not really that invasive, but it would be if I didn't have better care. Because I'm a state employee, I have fairly decent care. And I would ask Congressman Garrett what he would do, what he would suggest to me if I didn't have that care. My outcomes would be tremendously different. I have a treatable condition, and I work full time, and I have no problem doing that. I would like to continue to do that. But without that care, it's simply not possible. And that's just me. And I see a lot of people with different outcomes in the clinics that I see because they don't have decent care. I would ask Congressman Garrett what it is he thinks those people are going to do, and how it is he continues to ignore that medical care, when it's an emergent situation, is so much more expensive to the entire system than it is as a treatable thing along the way. And why does he not deal with that?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ms. Thornton.
Thank you. Hello, my name is Maggie Thornton. I am also a constituent of Mr. Garrett's, and I also have a pre-existing condition that made me bankrupt in my early 20s. And thanks to I was able to get the care that I need, and I no longer am in pain and have to worry about quitting my job and going on disability because of my AS. A week after Congressman Garrett was sworn in, I called his office and I asked, what's the plan? What are we going to do for people with pre-existing conditions like myself? And the very lovely woman who answered the phone said that Congressman Garrett had already prepared a letter, and she asked for my mailing address, and she said, I would get it in the mail. That was over a month ago. So my question is, where's my letter and what's the plan?
This goes to immigration and healthcare, and I spoke the same words across the county to Mr. Goodlatte. I'm one of those people whose grandparents came here fleeing the Nazis. My grandfather was a rabbi in a place that belonged sometimes to Poland and sometimes to Russia. All of my mother's family, except for her grandfather, were exterminated. I grew up hearing and seeing the faces and voices of my great aunts screaming in my nightmares. I am also a nurse. I do home care, and I have worked for the people of Nelson, Albemarle, Green, Fluvanna, Buckingham, Augusta, Rockbridge, and Rockingham counties for decades. I have done this regardless of what they personally believed about religion, politics, their lifestyle, or their economic or educational level. I fight as hard as I know how to for people's lives and for as much comfort as I can. And generally, I'm successful in making things better. I have worked with amazing nurses and doctors of all beliefs and from many places. I believe in live and let live. I currently teach classes to certify home health aides and medication aides for several agencies in this district, and I promise that when people are done with my training, they know what they are doing, and they are a benefit and not a safety hazard for the vulnerable people they serve. Some of the people I train have come here from other countries. I have trained people to be nurses' aides that are actually nurses and doctors in their native countries, and that are scarred, crippled, and have spent years in refugee camps. This is my country. I am personally scared and I am politically horrified by attacks on people based on who they are, what they are, or where they come from, rather than what they personally have done in their lives. That's a terrible road. That's not my country. That is betrayal, and we will suffer for that betrayal. Those who will suffer the most will be the children, the elderly, and the sick. What I want from Mr. Garrett is how he will staff rural and urban areas with healthcare workers.
Let's get a question from the back. Which one?
The guy right there. Stand it up.
Oh, there you go.
Thank you so much for organizing this event. It's wonderful. My name is Gabby Laufer. I am an immigrant. Well, I'm a citizen too. And my father was a Holocaust survivor. And I have seen the results of the rise of dictatorships. I'm afraid, I'm scared, and I don't know what we need to do to protect our democracy. I'm worried that our democracy is slipping away. There is assault on free press. There is assault on the public. Our representatives are not here. And my question is, what do we do? I'm not disagreeing that healthcare is important. I'm not disagreeing that science is important. But I think democracy stands above all. And I would like us to go and fight for it. It is important. It is our life. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name's Nathan. I'm from Crozet 22932. My comment is going to be nowhere near as eloquent as that gentleman's. My wife is a cancer survivor. She's alive because in her mid-20s, a malignant tumor was successfully cut out of her neck. So I have somewhat of a personal stake in healthcare myself. Congressman Garrett has said that one of the things he's going to do to fix healthcare is to repeal the McCarran-Ferguson antitrust exemption that would allow health insurers to sell care across state lines. This sounds great, it sounds intuitive, it's been backed by Democrats and Republicans in the past, but when they actually tried it in the real world, it didn't work. They tried it in Georgia shortly before the ACA was implemented, and they had no takers because insurance companies have to find networks of doctors that will serve their patients, and that's really hard when they're in another state and the network is in an entirely different place. So I'm wondering what Congressman Garrett thinks is going to work differently this time by repealing McCarran-Ferguson.
Hey, everybody. My name is Dave Brzezinski. I have a little thing I'm going to read. I'm writing as a constituent, business owner, and parent who is gravely concerned with the efforts by the Republican-led Congress to repeal the Affordable Care Act and deeply disheartened by my own congressman's acquiescence to this policy idea without putting forward or signing on to any coherent replacement plan. The ACA is by no means a perfect law, and there are many ways that it could be improved, but I use the marketplace exchanges, and the security that it provides my family is not replaceable by empty promises and lectures on freedom and personal responsibility from Republicans in Congress and the Trump administration. I'm a member of this community, a small business owner, and a parent of small children. I work very hard to support my family and to invest in the local economy and local businesses. If Congress repeals the ACA, my premiums will likely increase by around $700 per month. That is money that I currently spend employing people and purchasing goods and services in my community that will then be vacuumed out of state by large insurance companies. I cannot imagine how any congressman, particularly a Republican, a member of a party whose entire brand centers around a mythical adulation of self-reliant small business people, could in good conscience support an idea that is so bad for local economies. All right, I'm going to finish up here. When my daughter was 5 years old, she began to have seizures and was diagnosed with epilepsy. At the time, which was the year before the ACA took effect, she was on Virginia's SCHIP program, FAMUS. As a result, we were able to deal with the stress of caring for her and getting treatment without the additional stress of financial ruin. Make no mistake, if my daughter was on the crap policy that my wife and I were on at the time, without all the protections that the ACA provides that make all health insurance policies legitimate, we would have faced medical bankruptcy. We racked up over $40,000 worth of bills in short order, with no surgeries, invasive procedures, or anything complicated. Just an emergency room visit, preliminary test, a few specialist visits, and a single overnight in the hospital for an EEG. When Paul Ryan or Tom Price want to tell me that they are going to repeal Obamacare so that I can be empowered to have access to patient-centered care, what they are telling me is that caring for my daughter is less important than a huge tax cut for extremely wealthy people. I'm not exactly sure how personal responsibility would have kept my daughter from having seizures. All citizens of this country should have the right to real health insurance, and right now, that means the Affordable Care Act, so repealing it would be a grave and reckless mistake for our Congress to make. Okay? Now, that is not to say that there are not issues with the ACA, and as an enrollee and self-employed person, I can attest to some of these problems. But you can only solve these problems by leaving the law in place, not tearing it down. And our lawmakers should be inspired to do the work to solve these problems. I think lawmakers finding, well, actually very polite moms, at their town halls will find real allies among their constituents, however, if they engage in a good faith effort to improve the current system rather than double down on the sabotage that has marked Republican efforts over the last 7 years. Thanks.
Hello, I'm Rebecca Fox. I'm a pediatrician, and I've practiced in Virginia for 24 years taking care of children. My question to Tom Garrett is, if you got the ACA, what are you going to do to take care of the future of our country?
I'm Anna. I'm a student at Western Admiral High School, and I'm actually probably one of the only people here who's talked to Tom Garrett and seen him in person because he visited all the schools. yes. So I've actually asked him this question already, but I didn't get a very good answer, so I'm going to ask him again. My whole family is on the ACA because my dad had cancer, and that qualifies as a pre-existing condition, and so we couldn't get insurance because they don't get it through their employer. And my question is, how can you ensure, even if you mandate that they have to provide care for people with pre-existing conditions, that's going to be quality care that's lovingly given and not just because they have to? Thank you.
I'm Linda Stratford from Mecklenburg County, which is about 3 steps from North Carolina, and I'm asking the congressman very respectfully what he has for health care insurance.
My name is Susan Cable. I live in Scottsville. My question that is related very closely to health care deals with the health of our communities and more particularly the health of our environment. My question for Congressman Garrett is, how is he going to help us protect the planet when EPA is going, Scott Pruitt is going to roll back any number of regulations that protect our streams from coal ash, from fracking, from any number of things. It's an economic question, it's a social question, it's an ecological question. The economy, in the words of Gaylord Nelson, who most of us don't remember, is that the economy is a wholly owned subsidiary of the environment. So what is Congressman Garrett going to do to protect the future of our lands and waters in the Commonwealth of Virginia and the country as a whole?
My name is Joe Pastora. I've been on the front lines of mental health for years, and I want to tell you a story about when I was working at Johns Hopkins when President Reagan came to town and decided that he was going to release the hospitals and the psychiatric wards so that everybody would have the least restrictive environment. And all that money was going to follow us into the community. What we got was legions of homeless people with mentally ill conditions, okay? So I want our congressmen to assure us that when they're going to replace the Affordable Care Act, that there's going to be real health care and there will be real money to individuals to pay for it, okay? As opposed to just giving us rhetoric that, you know, we're gonna have all these things and then nothing happens. One more thing. I have watched all this happen personally to my mother, who's 90 years old. She used to be on Medicare with a supplemental insurance. She used to get her health care insurance through my father's company. They changed and they made us go to managed care, which was basically an HMO for Medicare. She broke her hip. They put a template on her coverage, and after a couple of days, we had 12 days, they discharged her. Not able to walk, not able to ambulate. They just dumped her out on a Sunday afternoon to the family and say, take care of her. And if we didn't, we were going to incur a bill of $600 a day in rehab, which she couldn't afford. So again, I asked the congressman, we want real health care, and then we want a real way to pay for it and make it affordable for regular Americans.
Thank you. If you have a question, please move to the aisle.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Monica Buckley, and I am at zip code 22903. And I wanted to point to something this woman had said about the environment before, because I think it's important that we understand how that affects our health and how our healthcare costs will rise when we don't have a healthy environment. At the same time that our government is trying to take away healthcare, they're also raising the risks of our getting sick with every rubber-stamped approval of every bad environmental policy. This could be a serious disaster. Tom Garrett, how do you intend on taking care of not only what is already going wrong with our health today, but how will you take care of our health care needs tomorrow after you have installed methane-producing pipelines into our water and our air? Question number one, thank you. Okay.
We have room for two more questions. Two more questions on healthcare. Great.
Question number two. As far as the ACA goes, why is it that when I have been spending months within the past year, I would add up my number of hours in the thousands of time that I have spent in hospitals with my parents, rehab centers, you name it, anything in between, and the amount of tests that are run on them, who, by the way, have excellent health care coverage, thank God. But where is this money going? If our country can't afford our insurance, I assure you it is not because the money isn't there. It's because it's going somewhere. I don't know. Where is it going? Because they have paid, their insurance companies have paid hundreds of thousands of dollars this year for tests, for this, for that, totally unnecessary things. When the hospitals are understaffed, where is our money going? Thank you.
My name is Paul Seehaver. If the congressman were here, I would ask him if he will support an independent counsel or an independent prosecutor to look into the relationship between the White House and the campaign. It is the single mark of freedom to have free election. I would ask him if he would support or even introduce that movement. Thank you.
One more question.
Hi, I'd like to add that I was a mortgage broker prior to the advent of the ACA, and in my profession, I was unfortunate to see so many people who were not able to obtain either a home loan to purchase a home or refinance a home due to an illness that brought bankruptcies because they weren't able to afford the health care they needed and also had pre-existing conditions. I've even had people who had insufficient coverage and were being foreclosed upon while a loved one was dying in the hospital, and their possessions were being put on the curb. Because of the lack of ACA and pre-existing conditions, I'd like to know what the economic proposal is going to be because of the fallout from people who will be declaring bankruptcy because they won't be able to cover their medical bills when it becomes a crisis and it's either paying their medical bills or paying their mortgage payment. And they will then be on the street. So has Congress considered the fallout and the taxpayer, the fallout to taxpayers that will become their responsibility when people who cannot afford and will not get insurance will end up declaring bankruptcy through no other means. So my question is, has Congress considered the economic fallout from the removal of the ACA?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Show me what democracy looks like. All right. Our next topic is immigration. Here's what Congressman Garrett said about immigration.
Tom Garrett has proposed the End Illegal Immigrant Plan, which stands for E, Erect the Border Wall. N, no benefit or employment for illegal aliens. D, defund sanctuary cities. He says, I will continue to oppose any benefit, incentive, shortcut, special programs, or any other action that rewards aliens from breaking the law and trampling their nose at our nation, our citizens, and our law. Tom Garrett has repeatedly expressed support for President Trump's ban on immigration from 7 predominantly Muslim countries. While rejecting the term Muslim ban, he blames Democrats for using this term, which he says will serve as a recruiting tool for ISIS and make America less safe at home and abroad. Please try to stay on topic on the issue of immigration. At the end, we'll have other issues to deal with.
And now for our testimony about immigration. I'd like to put the mic.
Hi, I'm Tina Vasquez. I'm a constituent here in Charlottesville, Virginia. While I do not represent Charlottesville City Schools at this moment, I cannot deny that I am a teacher. That is my profession. I teach English to speakers of other languages, and I teach becoming a global citizen. I work with our newcomer immigrants. You know, I work with our newcomer refugees and our newcomer undocumented immigrants. And my students just inspire me every day. You want to know what a Muslim refugee looks like, or even a refugee from Congo or from Syria? Look on the stage. Saad and Kibiriti are my students. Making this country great. They are our future. They are amazing. They're so compassionate. They're so involved. They are more engaged citizens than most US citizens I know. And many of us are too. And they're not even citizens yet. They're working on it. But I think about this sort of, where is this fear and the xenophobia coming from? And actually, I'll share that I personally am a child of immigrants, and one of my parents, my father, was an illegal alien. But because he was German and white, European, our family didn't have to face the same, you know, fear and racism, xenophobia, discrimination that my students face now. And I can tell you that while there's been some of that over the years, just right now the fear is palpable. There's been such a shift in the past few months. A lot of my students who you know, don't have papers, they're already talking about having to drop out of school and get a job for a couple months, save up what they can, and go back to their countries before they're deported, because they're just convinced that everyone is going to be deported. Every day they come and they talk about, they heard where someone was reported deported or where ICE was. They just live in constant fear. They can't even concentrate on anything. And likewise, a lot of my refugee students are concerned about family members, like, are they going to be able to come or not? Will they remain separated by continent indefinitely? This madness has to stop. And while I understand terrorism is a concern, and on a global scale, we need to keep addressing that. You or I have a greater chance of being killed by being struck by lightning or by a toddler than by a terrorist. Blocking people like my students from coming into this country is not going to benefit our country in any way. In fact, it's the opposite. You know, unless you're 100% Native American, you too are a child of immigrants. This is a nation of immigrants.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi there. First, let me say, I'm proud to be with this entire group here. This is fantastic. I'm most impressed. My name is Kevin Fitzpatrick, and unlike the young lady over here, I actually did get a response back on a question I asked to Representative Garrett on immigration a few days after the president signed the executive order banning immigration from those, banning immigration from those mostly seven mostly Muslim nations. I sent a letter, called them actually, and said, I don't think this is a good idea. You know, I can Google information. It doesn't look like these seven nations are the ones that are causing terrorism. That was kind of the, so he sends back a response. And what he basically says is, this is a national security issue. And he says, and I'm going to read it right to you. He says, I've been briefed on the issue. Now, that makes you believe intelligence briefing something. I don't know. But now, recently, we're finding out that the intelligence community is saying, not so much. You know, we're doing some research, and you know, this isn't the issue. So my question to the congressman is this. One, where did you get your briefing from? Or two, is this just a way to placate a constituent by saying, I have information you'll never have, and this is a good thing? So.
Tara, and I'm a constituent, zip code 22902. I find that a lot of these accusations from Tom Garrett or GOP, if once turned around, are kind of awkward. So, regarding immigration, I'd like to know, where did Tom Garrett's family come from, and why? What benefits were they seeking from our country? What safety? What instability were they escaping from? I'd kind of like to know the answers to these questions to see if Tom Garrett deserves to be here or not. Similarly, with healthcare, which we've already covered, he gets the gold standard healthcare paid by us. He keeps using the diversion and the excuse that we don't know yet what the new healthcare package is going to look like, but he needs to absolutely guarantee that it's going to look just as good, if not better, than the one we pay for him. As the lady just mentioned a few minutes ago, the number of people who are killed by Islamic radical immigrants, by the CDC's own numbers, on average from the last 10 years, is 2. Whereas the number lost to far right-wing terrorists is 5. The number lost to armed toddlers is 21. Falling out of bed, 737. And being shot by a fellow American, 12,000.
We have time for more questions.
Hello. My name's Simon. I'm from 22903, and I'm an immigrant. I'm also now a citizen. I come from a country, as some of you can tell, that is pretty popular here for the most part. We gave you Downton Abbey and the beginnings of democracy. So I've met with pretty much nothing but welcome here and help and encouragement and people's kindness. What I want to ask is, as an immigrant who's received that, please explain to me how the measures that are now being taken or attempted against refugees and citizens from Muslim countries and also from our friends south of the border, how they are anything but naked racism.
Good question.
Hi, my name is Mike Johnson, and I am a City of Charlottesville resident, so I am a constituent of Tom Garrett's. What I find really particularly troubling about this issue of immigration is that there's simply no context given to the situation. Why are these people coming here from various countries in the world? What is it that makes people want to come here? And when you start to look, just for example, for many of the Latino people who are here, I'm wondering if Tom Garrett is aware that according to the UN, in Guatemala, there was a genocide that took place there in the 1980s. Who supplied those weapons? It was our money and our military that supplied those. The situation is very similar in other countries, such as El Salvador. What about countries in the Middle East? What about Iraq? 1 million people are dead from a war that was based on lies. Why is there no context given to any of this? What about Libya? I mean, we could go on. What's going on now in Yemen? So to me, I'm wondering if Tom has any idea of what the history is of these various countries that so many refugees are coming to our country from. Thank you.
Two more questions.
Hi, my name is Sandy Cook, and I'm from Palmyra. And I'd like to read a letter that I wrote. It pertains to one person, but I think it speaks to immigration. In the past few days, something awful happened to Mem Fox, an old friend of mine. I met Mem 25 years ago when I was teaching in Peterborough, New Hampshire. She's a master storyteller and one of the finest children's book writers in our generation. She wrote Koala Lou, among many other books. She just published books about welcoming people to a new country. She has brought love of reading and learning to many children. She has brought love, joy, enthusiasm to classrooms and families, and she's taught many teachers the value of literature and culture. She sparkles and inspires. Her autobiographies, Dear Man Fox, and Radical Reflections have been on my bookshelf for years. Several days ago, she came from Australia to the United States to promote reading and love of learning with her books and her talks. She was stopped and detained by ICE. She was humiliated and bullied. She said she cried like a baby. This 70-year-old woman who brought everyone such joy and happiness with her books and wonderful personality said she has never been treated with so much indignity or has never been so frightened. This is unbelievable and unacceptable. No human being should be treated this way. We must all work to stop this happening in our country. Let's look at another point and look from another view. Tourist trade is down the past month or so and will probably go down even more as time goes by. People are afraid to come here. I thought that this administration intended to create more jobs, and it seems like many will be lost. Also, Australia is one of our strongest allies. How do you think the Australian people and government feel about their beloved mem, a grandmother, and one of their country's treasures being humiliated and bullied by thugs? We must resist. We must resist with pride, dignity, and purpose. No matter how low they go, we must go high.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. We have time for one more question.
Hello.
One more.
My name is Gladys Guzman. I'm a Colombian citizen and USA citizen. And I'm married to an Indonesian who happens to be a USA citizen. My question to this gentleman who's not here, and who apparently represents us, is, how do you justify raids and separating families from the children because you consider them criminals because they're illegal? Last Friday, a great group of people got gathered in Charlottesville to help families, Hispanic families. I'm so sorry. Translate power of attorneys so they, if they are arrested, they're able to make sure that the children are with somebody, that their property is protected if for some reason they're arrested in any raid that is happening every day in any state. So, can he answer to me, what are you gonna do with those kids? What's gonna happen to those kids? How can the parents be reassured that the people that are gonna take care of them are gonna take care of them the same way a parent will do? And I ask that as a parent of a kid who has immigrant parents. How could you do that?
Our final topic is education. Let's hear first from Representative Tom Garrett's own word.
Here is what Tom, Congressman,
Sorry. Yeah. Here is what Tom Garrett has said about education. Tom Garrett believed that the Department of Education has had a disaster impact on education in this country. He says he will support efforts to reduce, roll back, or eliminate the Department of Education and its demands. However, Garrett also believed that college students who receive federal aid should not be able to choose their program of studies.
Show me what democracy looks like.
He says, part of the runaway student loan problem that we face is that we have promised federal money to anyone to study anything for any length of time without any thought to repaying the money borrowed. To address debt, Garrett has proposed the so-called student security program, which asks graduates to give up future Social Security payment. In exchange for short-term debt relief.
Next, we'll hear from a constituent testimonial about education.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jen Horn. And though I am not representing Charlottesville City Schools, I am a teacher here at Charlottesville High School. You're very lucky to do that. And I will say that although I'm not representing the school system, it was really awesome to have someone in the education system asked to speak about education. I'm not going to talk for long because I'm sure after hearing Tom Garrett's wonderful words, you have many things to say, as do I. I would just say, please be on the lookout for House Resolution 610, which is looking to dismantle our education system as it is right now, which is dangerous to our country, to our future, and to our children. Voucher systems don't work. There is ample research out there to support that. They will de-educate, they will resegregate, and they will lead to a downfall in our education. The most powerful thing is that there is no longer going to be control or oversight in a voucher-based system. What might happen then is that critical thinking will suffer. Our current school systems, our public schools today, are starting to revamp interest in critical thinking. Our students today are questioning our thinking. Please don't take that away from them, Mr. Garrett.
Thank you. My name is Bill Bryant. I worked for Senator Claiborne Pell for 20 years. He was chairman of the Education Subcommittee and the father of the Pell Grants. The Pell Grants are under attack because they're portable. The students who get them on the basis of need can choose their college. They don't have to apply. They have to take the grant with them to the college. This is because the senator believed that education is a right. I have one more thing I learned from Senator Pell, and that is that the true strength of a nation is determined not by its weapons of destruction or its machines of construction, but by the education and character of its people.
Thank you. I'm Shelley Hansen, and I live in Fauber. I am one of Tom Garrett's constituents, and I appreciate what you say about public education. I'm 55 years old, and thankfully went to an awesome public school in Minnesota and a state college. Got my master's degree. And I'm so grateful for that, because the thing that it taught me is how to be a critical thinker, how to ask questions. And I think it's so important for our kids today to be able to know what is truth and what is fiction. I'm always very curious when people say certain words, like, what does that really mean? And today I've been, well, for the past, I'm sure as everybody is, been contemplating what is the meaning of terrorism? It's something that we hear all the time from our president straight down to the majority of the GOP and our representative Garrett. It's a way to discriminate against people and people's religion. So from the Merriam-Webster dictionary, terrorism, this is a definition of terrorism for English language learners. The use of violent acts to frighten the people in an area as a way of trying to achieve a political goal. So as I think about that, it's like, I've been reading a lot of what Garrett has been voting on. In my opinion, our president and many of the leaders of the GOP, as well as Tom Garrett, are committing terrorist acts. Against our immigrant communities, against humanity in general, against our children who deserve good education, against people who deserve a right to take care of their bodies, their minds, and their spirits, and our environment. Garrett, in every one of his votes, has sought to destroy and be what I defined is a terrorist. And I ask him to now, will you please go use your education to look up the meaning and have some introspection about how you're going to move forward to support all lives and your constituents.
Thank you.
My name is Natalie, and I'm a proud student of Monticello High School, an Albemarle County public school. And I've also had the opportunity to talk to Tom Garrett when he was touring our Health and Medical Sciences Academy at Monticello High School. And, you know, my question for him is, if you defund our public schools, if you listen to people like Betsy DeVos, what's going to happen to students in that program who are going to become our future doctors and medical experts? And for people like me who have had the opportunity to have an internship where I'm doing research to help fight climate change. And and for students at our school who, without free lunches, would starve. And when I spoke to him and asked him, and, you know, I told him about my internship and what we're doing, and I told him that climate change is a huge issue and probably the biggest issue of our time, he looked at me and told me, yeah, climate change is a really great opportunity for businesses. And I want to ask him, do businesses come before the future of our planet?
I'm Donna Price. I'm a lawyer. I'm also a retired Navy captain. I served 25 years on active duty in the Navy. I watched the movie last night, I Am Not Your Negro, and you need to go see it. What this administration is doing is trying to bring us back to the days before Brown versus the Board of Education. They talk nice. They say they want prayer in the schools, but they only want their prayer in the schools. When they talk state rights, that's a euphemism for discrimination. When they talk religious freedom restoration, they're talking about hate. I'm a transgender woman. We need to protect all of our children in the schools.
Two more questions.
Hi, everyone. I'm Mike Signer. I'm the mayor of Charlottesville. Not here talking about city stuff. We did do a press conference a couple weeks ago that, like this, blew up. In 2 days, there were 700 people there, and it was to talk about the city being a capital of the resistance. And people have been saying, well, what does that mean? This is what that means. So, I'm very proudly the product of a public elementary school, public junior high school, and two public colleges. And when I look at, Tom Garrett's website doesn't even have, on all three of these questions, doesn't even have a section on healthcare. But it does have a big red box that says, stewardship means not trading the liberty of future Americans for the whims of today's. My question is, what the hell does that mean? That's my question.
My name's Kelsey Kauger. I'm a constituent of Representative Garrett's, 22920. I'm also a former professor of the humanities and a product of public education. And my question to this empty chair over there is whether or not Representative Garrett cares about or supports the arts, the humanities, and the social sciences. That's part one. Part two, if he does care about those things, and I suspect he'd say so, whether or not he thinks they're only available to rich people.
We have time for one more question.
Sorry, I've been chasing him all over this side of the room, so I'm going to take my time. So my name is Jenny Poole. I'm a doctoral student in higher education. So needless to say, I am very frightened by what comes out of the mouths of people sitting on side of the right-hand side of the aisle right now with regards to higher ed. And this week, we saw our federal government roll back protections for transgender students under Title IX. And it's alarming because what I study is campus sexual assault. And as many people may or may not know, it's executive actions that were taken under Title IX by President Obama that have reinforced protections for college students related to peer sexual violence. This is specifically outlined in the 2011 Dear Colleague letter and the 2014 guidance on campus sexual assault. So given the fact that violence against college women is a priority for Virginians, and that the University of Virginia has already been through too much of this, Congressman Garrett, I would ask, can we count on you to continue to support Title IX as a policy for protecting college students from campus sexual assault, and refuse to support any efforts to roll back federal guidance in this regard? I can tell you it is already underway. I have a friend who worked for a Republican congressman, who is already putting plans into place to roll back Title IX's uses related to sexual assault, and I am completely dismayed. So, thank you.
We now have time for any other questions.
Yes, I will stand. Okay. Wow, this is a great crowd. Remember when Howard Dean like yelled up on the stage? This is what I can see why he did that, because this is empowering. Okay, so my name's Anna. I work for NARAL Pro Choice Virginia right now, but this is a, thank you. This is a personal story. Thank you, Donna, also for saying what you said. I want to talk about being LGBT as a child and coming up through the private and public school system. This is totally off the cuff, so please bear with me. So I did attend K through 8, a Catholic private school, and I was told at that school that it was not okay to love somebody from the same sex. I was told it multiple times by multiple different people, and I was told to get used to hot temperatures. So when I entered the public school system, I was so surprised by how much diversity was at my high school. I made it something, I wanted to champion the rights of LGBT students. So me and my friends started the first GSA at our high school, and this was back in 2009 before, thank you. Before the whole momentum went forward. So my friends and I, we started this GSA. We had no clue who was going to come. We were putting ourselves out there by putting, you know, flyers all over school, posters all over school, saying, come to this event, outing ourselves, essentially. Well, I wasn't out then, but it was kind of obvious. and we showed up. We were lucky enough to have a German teacher who was super supportive of us. She lent us our room. When we walked into the room, we were shocked because the entire room was filled with people, and they all wanted to help. And I know that some people think that, you know, there's nothing wrong with private schools. I learned a lot at private school, but under the Department of Education, you have a lot more protections if the Trump administration decides to keep those protections. As you said about trans kids, we were afforded a lot of protections from Obama to protect LGBT people, but right now the Trump administration wants to take all those away. My life would be completely different if I didn't have a public school that was open and welcoming to me, and trans kids' lives, LGBT kids' lives, are on the line because we have the highest suicide rate amongst any children. We have the highest homeless rate amongst any type of children. We do not want to go back there. We have our marriage, but that's not enough. We are not going to go back. I will not let them put us back.
Thank you so much.
But Tom Garrett, so my question to Tom Garrett is, how are you going to protect LGBT kids if you're going to roll back all of these provisions?
Thank you. All right, my thinking is about the game plan of the right. First of all, they want to discredit anything that affects corporations and their ability to make a lot of money. Scientists are being discredited. It is not any longer possible to listen to scientists who say that there is climate change, and that its effects are going to affect all of us. It's happening rather quickly, actually. And in order to get their agendas through, they have to appeal to a base that doesn't want cultural things like transgender freedom and all of that. It's all part of a game plan. And I think in terms of education, what we need to do is educate Congress to listen to scientists and plan. You know, they're blind because actually they could pursue an agenda that which would prevent climate change or at least stop it, try to stop it, and still have a lot of business interests in this country. They're blind to that. Okay,
thank you.
All.
We have time for two more. Two more.
My name is Craig, and I'll make this as quick as I can. This is a little story I'd like to share with you, and I wish that that Congressman Garrett were here with us today so I could ask him my question for the third time to see if I could get a straight answer. I actually phoned in a question to the Facebook town hall on the 13th, and my question was selected. What I asked was, I had written this down beforehand and dictated it to the young woman who took my question. I said, please explain the wisdom of getting rid of the ACA immediately without a suitable replacement. Remember Trump's promise that there would be better health care for all. With the difficulty there is certain to be in Congress in formulating a workable plan, why should we believe that a new plan would be forthcoming at all, let alone in a timely manner? What is the rationale for getting rid of the ACA without a suitable replacement? That was my question that I dictated to the young woman that took my call. When my question was presented to Mr. Garrett, this is what was related to him. We have a constituent, Craig DeBose, out of Charlottesville, who is asking for more details on Obamacare replacement. Just getting down into the weeds a little bit more on, I know better GOV, better.gov has, we've put some ideas and a framework out there for healthcare. Can we just continue to expand on that a little bit more? That was not the question that I asked. So the next day, I phoned Congressman Garrett's office and spoke to Andrew Griffin and told him I was not very happy about the way that my question was presented, and the answer that was given was not satisfactory. And he agreed to read my question on the 15th, verbatim, again. And so it came up on the 15th. He actually did read my question verbatim. But then he paired it with another question which had nothing to do with the question that I asked. And so for the second time, Congressman Garrett talked about McCarran-Ferguson and went on for about 6 minutes not answering my question. The next morning, I called back and spoke to Andrew Griffin again. And I said, I'm still not very happy. Let me just point out to you that a Facebook town hall is no good for anyone if the questions can't be accurately transmitted to the congressman. I went on to point out that the congressman had wasted 12 minutes of his time, one else's, by answering a not asked. So I encourage you to try to engage constructively with them and keep the pressure on. And is anyone from Congressman Garrett's staff here today? No one from the staff? Well.
Last question. Last question.
Hi, my name is Peter Cools. I'm in 22903. My question for Representative Garrett. The Constitution starts with we the people. And my question for the congressman is, does he believe that that should include women, LGBTQI, people of color, and diverse religious beliefs, rather than just rich white men? Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. Our town hall has now came to an end. We want to thank everyone who came out today, coming to here to be heard.
Congratulations, everyone. To everyone here for insisting the need of a town hall, thank you, and let's keep this momentum going. Thank you.
On behalf of all the convening organizations, thank you so much for coming to the People's Town Hall. Please join me in thanking our moderators, Saad and Kibiriti, and our timekeepers and all the volunteers. Guys, I look forward to voting for you guys for Congress, okay?